Good day to you. We're here in the Adirondacks at ESF's Cranberry Lake Biological Station, and we're here to explore an interesting problem in locomotion, specifically involving these creatures, water striders, or pond skaters, as they're sometimes called. Water striders are an interesting problem in locomotion because they sit on surface tension at the interface between air and water. They're neither aquatic nor terrestrial, but a little bit of both. And here's the quandary. When they move, are they really walking or are they really swimming? As we'll see, there's a surprising answer to this question. But first, we have to catch some water striders. Catching water striders is a little bit tricky. These animals are members of an insect family, the Gerardi, members of the true bugs, or the Hemiptera. They're sit-and-wait predators. That is, they sit and wait until an insect falls on the surface of the water. Then when they sense the vibrations of the insect struggling, they pounce on the insect and they feed off of it. They're quite voracious predators. But because of that, they're quite wary. We have to sit and wait for them to come to us. And when they do, maybe we can catch one. Here comes one now. Need to be quite careful. Got one. Okay, we're ready to start.
The place to start is how water striders stand on water in the first place. They use a clever trick with surface tension. The tarsi of their feet are coated with a dense mesh of non-wettable hairs, shown here at high magnification. When this leg is pressed against the water surface, surface tension repels it. This prevents the water strider from sinking. Let's think a bit more carefully about surface tension. Surface tension is a measure of surface energy at the interface between air and water. Being a measure of surface energy, the surface tension, usually symbolized with a lowercase gamma, therefore has units of joules per square meter. Surface energy is essentially a measure of how much work is required to create more water surface. Left to its own, as in this falling stream, water will always seek to minimize its surface energy. This happens when the continuous stream pulls itself apart and forms into drops. Let's now perform a little trick with units. Joules per square meter is dimensionally equivalent to newtons per meter, that is, force per length. This force is also called capillary tension. You can think of it as a force that runs parallel to the water surface, pulling the surface together. Standing on water can now be made more sensible. The water strider has a certain weight, W newtons. Each of its six legs supports some fraction of this. For now, let's say each leg tip presses down on the water surface with a force of W over 6 newtons. The water surface therefore dimples under the force, increasing the amount of water surface area. As the water surface expands, its surface tension will increase until it pushes upward on the leg with an opposite force of minus W over 6 newtons. The minus sign just means the force is pointing up. At this point, the water strider will sit stably on the surface. The weight of a real water strider, like this one, does not appear to be distributed evenly among the six legs, however. Note how the dimples under the forelegs and hind legs are deeper than those under the long middle legs. This indicates that most of the water strider's weight is supported on its fore and hind legs. This will be significant in a moment. But first, we can use surface tension to predict an upper size limit to just how large a water strider can be. Here's how. A water strider's weight will increase with size. In fact, weight will scale roughly to the third power of the insect's length, L. Meanwhile, the surface tension supporting the insect is determined by the length of the contact zone between the leg and the water. Thus, surface tension supporting the insect will scale to the one power of length, or directly to the insect's length. We can plot these two variables out on a double log plot of length on the x-axis, and log W and log gamma on the y-axis. Obviously, there will be some body size at which weight exceeds the capacity of surface tension to hold it up. At weights larger than this, a water strider sinks. To get around this limit, water striders have an interesting trick up their sleeves, so to speak. If leg length increases disproportionate to body length, that is, if large water striders have disproportionately long legs, this maximum size can be pushed higher. Based upon the observed size range of water striders, the upper limit to this trick appears to be about 20 centimeters body length. Now let's take a look at how water striders actually move. Here is some slow motion imagery of a water strider on the quiet patch of water where we caught them. The main thing to notice here is the motion of the middle legs. The water strider propels itself forward with a vigorous backward stroke of the middle legs. The fore and hind legs appear mainly to act to support the body. This form of locomotion has been likened to rowing. It's not quite rowing, though. Let's take a look at the water strider from the side as it propels itself forward. We have to film this at high speed, about 1,000 frames per second, so we have to do this in a special apparatus in the laboratory. What's remarkable here is that the water strider doesn't really row. Rather, it leaps, launching itself off the surface of the water, and then landing, if that's the right word, and gliding along the surface until it stops. It's over very fast, in about an eighth of a second. Let's break this down. The actual power stroke with the middle legs takes about 25 milliseconds. The water strider is airborne for about 40 milliseconds. It touches down first with its hind legs, and then with its forelegs 10 milliseconds later. It then coasts for about 50 milliseconds. All this would be unremarkable, of course, if the water strider was leaping off a solid surface. But keep in mind we're talking about a liquid here, a fluid that gives. And here's the problem. How does the water strider get forward momentum if it can't push against something solid? There's a theory for this. Suppose the water strider pushes against the dimpled surface of the water beneath his feet. The reaction force against the angled surface of the dimple could then launch the beetle forward. Because the surface is liquid, though, pushing back on the water in this way would create a surface wave that spreads back from the insect. These waves are the most pleasant thing about watching these insects flit about on the surface of the water. There's a problem with this idea, however. The physics of surface waves leads to an apparent paradox, namely that water striders smaller than a certain size should not be able to walk on the water. And yet water striders of all sizes manage it just fine. This paradox is called Denny's paradox, after Mark Denny, the California biophysicist who pointed it out. To see the problem, we have to look a bit more deeply at the physics of surface waves. It turns out there are two types of surface waves, one initiated by vertical displacement of the water surface, and the other by horizontal displacement. A vertical displacement of a water surface produces a so-called gravity wave. You can produce a gravity wave by dropping a pebble into the water. The pebble dropping to the surface pushes water down, which gravity works to restore. Because the water has mass, it gains momentum as it accelerates upward and rebounds upward above the water surface. The water surface therefore oscillates vertically up and down, similar to the motion of a pendulum. A horizontal displacement of a water surface produces a so-called capillary wave. Surface tension, also called capillary tension, resists any horizontal deformation of the water surface, just as gravity resists any vertical deformation. A bubble on the surface is a good example of such a horizontal deformation. When the bubble bursts, capillary tension snaps the water surface back to flat. In both cases, any deformation of the water surface from its equilibrium state, namely a flat surface, requires work to be done. Release of that deformation releases that energy, which spreads away as a wave. Here's the problem for the water strider. If it pushes against the dimpled surface of the water, it will do work on the water surface, deforming it. This generates the wave that radiates away, that is a mixed capillary and gravity wave. The surface of the dimple, therefore, recedes backward away from the backwardly moving leg. For the water strider to move forward, the leg has to be pushed back faster than the dimple retreats away. Here's the origin of Denny's paradox. It has two parts. The first is the speed of retreat of the wave. As it happens, mixed capillary and gravity waves have a minimum speed. Let's call this Vmin. For water surface and air, this is about 23 centimeters per second. To move forward, then, a water strider has to be able to move the tip of its leg backward at a horizontal velocity of at least 23 centimeters per second. Now for the second part. The leg operates as an oar, swept through a horizontal arc by a muscle in the body. The leg's angular velocity, let's call this omega, is therefore determined by how fast this muscle can shorten. There is an inherent upper limit to this, which means that the backward sweep of the leg has a maximum angular velocity. Let's call this omega max. The maximum horizontal velocity of the leg's tip is therefore the product of the cosine of omega max and the leg's length. Below a certain body size, therefore, the leg tip's maximum horizontal velocity will fall below Vmin. Below this point, the water strider should not be able to move forward. Yet small water striders manage to move about just fine, hence Denny's paradox. Denny's paradox, like any paradox, is in fact an invitation to look at the problem in another way that might have seemed unimaginable before. So here's the unimaginable other possibility. Perhaps a water strider is not actually walking on the water, but is actually swimming on it. Is that even possible, one might say, when the water strider is not really in the water at all? Denny's paradox forces us to explore the possibility. Let's start by asking fundamentally what swimming is. A body swims by imparting backward momentum to a parcel of water. Specifically, it involves imparting momentum to a vortex. We can test this. We set up a special apparatus in the laboratory and let a water strider walk around on it. To visualize any water movements, we inject a very fine ribbon of fluorescein dye. If we position the ribbon just below the surface and prompt the water strider to move through it, we might be able to visualize a vortex. So, let's go. Here's the dye injection. Let's give the strider a goose, and there he goes, right across the ribbon of dye. Looks like the strider's disturbed the water all right. This wouldn't happen with a surface wave. Let's take a closer look. Note how the left leg is positioned just after the ribbon before the strider leaps. When he does leap, the ribbon is disturbed. That's a vortex right there. To see how extensive this is, look at the smooth cloud of dye just behind the strider's leg. It's disturbed too. There's a lot of energy being transferred to the water. Let's take a look at this from the side now. Here comes the dye ribbon. And there goes the water strider. There's a vortex again. Let's take a closer look. As the strider lands, it disturbs the ribbon slightly. But when it takes off again, the dimple is pushed down, then back, and there's clear turbulence in the wake. Here's an interesting clip. You can see the underside of the dimples in the water surface made by the feet. Notice how the dye stream flows around the dimple. In this case, the strider is trying to climb up the wall, but notice the small turbulent vortex behind the leg as it tries to push itself up off the water surface. The vortex isn't just for accelerating, though. It's also involved in decelerating the bug. See here how the middle leg doesn't catch the dye stream, but the hind leg does as it glides to a halt. And notice the long stream of dye dragged out behind the hind leg. This is viscous entrainment of the fluid with the dimple. This is why the water strider glides to a halt. Its forward momentum is bled off as heat by this viscous interaction. But just how extensive is the momentum imparted to the water? We can gauge this by spreading dye widely over the water surface. The happenings are easier to see if we tweak the images a bit to make the green of the dye stand out. And here are two of these clips side by side. See how the dye traces are disturbed over a wide area. It's clear that the momentum imparted to the water is substantial and widespread. Particularly interesting are the two prominent vortices that spread back from the middle limbs. So, the verdict is in. Water striders don't walk against surface tension, they swim, even though they're not actually in the water. Denny's paradox is resolved.
Okay, let's put these guys back and review what we've learned. First, we saw that water striders actually leap off the surface of the water, getting slightly airborne before they land and glide to a halt. This makes perfect sense in hindsight. Leaping is what all sit-and-wait predators do. Second, we learned that there really is no special physics behind this leap. For a time, it was thought that water striders propelled themselves forward by pushing against a dimpled surface of the water under their feet. Rather, we saw that water striders move through a peculiar form of swimming by imparting backward momentum to a mass of water just underneath the surface. Okay, that's all for now. Until we meet again, this is Scott Turner wishing you a good day.